Reboot, you some gum.
Boo.
Thank you.
Oh no, I don't believe it, man.
All kinds of critters trying to get ASCs up in here.
I'm gonna start it off right. Don't miss it.
I'm starting to think people don't take this virus seriously. You wouldn't leave a contagious mask hanging on your turn signal or your ignition lock cylinder or your shifter if you were really worried about it, right?
Right, guys, welcome back to the channel, Making It Work. I'm Jimmy. If you haven't been here before, we're starting week 14. Week in the shop, episode 14. I'm gonna finish up my rear main seal, and Bill's gonna take out the garbage. AMS oil change. And I'm gonna get the subframe back in this mad mamma jamma. So this is my shin guard. I didn't want to move the jack, so I just put a shin guard around the subframe. So that's gotta go back in this morning. That's my first task.
Customer didn't say anything about it running rough. Jeez Louise. Just kidding.
All right, subframe's in. It really helps on these if you jack the transmission and engine up far enough that the bolts for the mounts are barely near the holes for the subframe, because if you put the subframe back in with the engine and transmission hanging low a little bit, then getting these bolts lined up is a real pain in the ass. So make note of that if you do work on one of these things. Get the engine and tranny up high enough that the mounts aren't in your way, putting the subframe back up. F-150 4x4, I told him needed a motor last week. Now we're doing an evaporator. It's losing Freon in about 2 days now. The crack must have got bigger. Went from a slow leak to a fast leak. So now he's gonna live with the motor noise and cam codes and rough running and stalling. And we're gonna put an evaporator in it. No, seriously. I'll be quiet.
There she blows, F-150 evaporator.
You can see dye at the drain. That's where it's coming from. Somewhere in these fins, it looks like something's cracked inside. Covered in debris too, much like the rest of the vehicle. Covered in debris. I spent about an hour clearing out cockroaches and sunflower seeds and Reese's peanut butter cups. It's a farm truck, so I guess he's not too worried about how clean he keeps it, so it's kind of a rolling garbage can. All right, new evaporator's in. I'm doing a vacuum leak check with the machine. Before I put the dash up, make sure it's gonna be good. These aftermarket parts nowadays, you can't trust any of them. So, and as I said in other videos, but you see that vacuum gauge pinned down on 30? You got no leaks. Because if you have a leak, it won't go under 25, 26 inches of vacuum. So, something to note. Going back together. Be done before lunch today. What time is it now? 8:40. I'm gonna have this thing done by 11:30. Big money. 5 after 10. It's all set. Old pressure. Interior is all done. Just gotta hook up the battery and fire it up. Not too bad. That's one good thing Ford does. They make their dashes easy to get in and out. I mean, that probably the easiest part of the job is probably pulling the dash. It's harder to get the box off the firewall once the dash is out of the way than it is to get the dash out of the way, even with the scrap pile in the back seat. So I couldn't get the console bolts. I had to use a wrench to get down there for the console bolts. A quarter inch socket and ratchet. But it's all done. We'll fire it up, check the pressures, and take it for a road test. Genesis said the tune up and the throttle body on. Customer side to go ahead and take care of the front brakes, and we heard a bad bearing. But they're gonna hold off on the coolant leaks for now. Running out of money. I would have done the coolant leak before the bearing myself. There isn't even any play in it yet, it's just noisy. But it's got a coolant leak and it could damage the engine. So apparently they're gonna put that off. Ford Escape, 70,000 miles. Came down from New Jersey. First brake job. Calipers are frozen, can't get them back. Boo. I hate salty roads. New Jersey.
Good Lord, look at the rust on this thing.
Like a 2016. Where's this thing gonna be in 5 years? Scrapyard.
2011 Mercedes.
Got a random misfire. We tried moving a plug and a coil from cylinder 5 to 6. Listen to the YouTube. Suction noise in the intake intermittently, and that's when the engine shakes. I think there's a valve hanging up because of carbon in the valve. We're gonna
try an induction service.
2012 Ford Taurus. Customer states my car won't start, and coincidentally the key fob stopped working. Car only has 57,000 miles on it.
They can't understand why the key fob don't work and at the same time the engine won't start, but the battery is dead. I ran it a few minutes after jump starting it. And the battery is so bad that it's no good. It's not even gonna start one time after letting it run for 5 or 10 minutes.
Well, it only needs a battery. Damn it, it's an easy one. Give me something hard.
Coil we're gonna change and then we're gonna do an induction service. Just like the other Mercedes, this has a random misfire at idle. It's flagging cylinder 5 only. So I wonder if a valve's hanging up, but I told him we need to pull the intake and try moving the coil first. But Joe's just done that on the other Mercedes over there. The thing is, since you're watching making it work, I wanted to show you guys something, how we make things work. Got out my trusty Blue Point E10 to take the intake bolts off. And so you got to raise this up to sneak the coil out. But this Blue Point socket doesn't fit. You can't get it down there. The bolt's about 3 inches down. So I had to use a Vim Universal. It's just narrower enough that it fits down in the hole. That little bit of a, it's probably 100 thousandths. Just a little bit narrower. So it fits down in the hole so I can get the intake up. And I'm not gonna lift it up all the way. I jammed a piece of wood in there just so I can lift the coil out and then I can put it back together. Mercedes is running pretty good. It's awful noisy in the background because it's raining real hard.
Central Florida rain. It's coming down. I could run out there with a bar of soap and take a shower.
It was sideways a minute ago.
This is going to be a public service announcement video. Seems like there's some confusion about how automatic air conditioning systems work in vehicles. I get in a lot of vehicles and the air conditioning system, even a high-end car with automatic AC, the air conditioning system's been turned off. I just wanted to let people know a few things about the way an automatic HVAC system works.
The first thing is, you don't have to turn the HVAC on and off. The HVAC system will turn itself on and off. When you turn your engine off, the computer turns off the relay and the AC compressor and all those kinds of things. At the same time, it's not going to stay on when you turn your engine off. When you start your car up with the HVAC system on, the engine will start. The computer looks at a few different sensors based on temperatures, pressures within the AC system, all those kinds of things. And the computer sees your AC request. When you push that button on, you don't turn the compressor on and off. When you push that button on, you're telling the HVAC control panel is telling the engine computer and a couple of the other computers what's going on. And it's saying, hey, we have an air conditioning request. So then the ECM looks at a few things like engine temperature, outside air temperature, things like that, pressure in the AC system. And it says, yes, you can, or no, you cannot have AC. And if the conditions are correct, it turns on your AC compressor. This could take, that's why sometimes you'll notice it might take 30 seconds to a minute for your AC to start blowing colder. That's because your computer's determining whether you get to have air conditioning or not. So there's no reason to turn your AC panel off when you turn your engine off, or just before you turn your engine on. And then you don't have to turn it back on after you start your car, turn the AC back on. You don't have to do that. There's no reason to get in your car, start the engine, then turn the AC back on, and then adjust the temperature down to get it colder. It's not gonna get colder. The air conditioning system is designed, it's gonna work at maximum. If there's a big disparity between the temperature in the car and the temperature you want, it's going to turn on and blow as cold as it possibly can until it gets close. Adjusting the numbers down on the dashboard so you see a colder temperature doesn't make it blow colder. When it gets to your target temperature, it'll ease up and the fan will slow down. It'll get nice and quiet in the car again. You won't even have to think about it. If everything's working in the car correctly, it's going to take care of all that for you. So, modern technology. You'll probably see this in This Week in the Shop, episode 14, and it'll be in a separate video as a public service. I even get in mechanics' cars, and they're messing with the temperatures in their automatic climate control cars, which is okay. But at least if you know how it works,
then you know what you need or don't need to do, and you can still obviously do whatever you want. If you want to mess the temperature, it makes you feel better, you can. I just wanted people to know they don't have to.
See, this system was set on 61 when I got in the car, and then I had to turn it on, and it's a 61 blowing really hard. 61, you wouldn't keep your house at 61, right? So if you put it on 70, let's say, you have the fan slow down. Isn't that nice? 70's real comfortable, and the fan's really quiet. 70's awesome. If you had 70 in your house, you'd have to wear a jacket. The closer you are to your threshold, the lower the fan runs and the happier everything gets.
That's nice. It's quiet. It's cool. It's comfortable.
It's raining like a bitch outside, though.
Customer states, ever since you did my ball joints, they're squeaking.
Except it's the leaf springs squeaking. So give them an estimate for leaf springs.
Cadillac's got a PO442 evap small leak code.
So I'm going to go out and loosen the gas cap and see if the fuel tank pressure changes.
No change. Now we're going to induce purge and see if it changes. Evap, purge, and seal.
Pretty crazy. The clouds out there today.
Fuel tank pressure sensor. Still reading zero. There you go. It's not sealed. So something's going on with the vent solenoid or the gas cap. So now what I'll do is I'll go back up to 50%. Go over to the gas cap. I'll loosen the gas cap. Pressure starts dropping, or vacuum starts dropping. It's still pulling a purge. So the cap's doing something. It's not leaking bad if it is the cap. I think we put a purge and a canister in this one not too long ago.
Maybe the purge valve is intermittently not working.
Something's going on with the purge valve on this Cadillac. The pressure drops and the purge valve stops clicking even with it commanding it on. And if I grab it back here, if I touch the purge valve by the connector, it starts working again. You hear it clacking away. Then we'll start pulling the vacuum again. Then it'll stop clacking and I jiggle the connector. So there's something going on with the connector or the purge valve itself. I'm gonna have to get my voltmeter in there. If you listen, you can hear the little purge valve back there. The purge valve kind of turns on and off.
See this go back?
I put a quality compressor in this about 3 weeks ago. In my Week in the Shop series, it was in there. Customer says the AC's warm, it's not working anymore. It's got a bad compressor clutch. It's not even a month old. Bastards. Took the Buick Rondevious for a ride and lifting up to make sure it's not leaking. And also got to do an alignment. The steering wheel is slightly off because I had the rack and the whole cradle out of it. And I went ahead and aligned it. But I'm pretty sure you all got to get it all green.
If it keeps raining like this, we're going to have to start working on boats.
2008 Cadillac. Customer states, I had to jumpstart my car to get it running.
Check it, find out what's wrong with it. I don't have any money. I hope you guys can fix it. It's charging good, but the battery's toast.
Brought in my mower blades to sharpen today, and I mean, they're pretty bad. I haven't sharpened them in like 3 years. I realized pretty quickly that they're probably about as sharp as the handle of a butter knife. That'll cut the grass. Ow! Oh, that's sharp. Ow, careful.
Kind of weird, this Cadillac, I put a battery in, it had a dead battery. Started a bunch of times, no problems. Took it for a road test to relearn the idle, got back. I shut it off and started it one more time. And the starter just kind of spun. Woo! And didn't turn the engine and wouldn't stop spinning. Even when I turned the key off, it kept spinning. I had to disconnect the battery. So now I put a starter in it. Kind of weird, the Bendix is just freewheeling and the solenoid must have melted together. Car quest started.
There you go, boom. Like a brand new car.
All right, new purge valves in the Cadillac. Now you can see just on 20%, it's pulling a good vacuum and it's consistent, doesn't drop off. The other purge valve was intermittently just shutting off even though the command was on. It would just shut off and then it would actually leak up. This is the purge seal, by the way. You can go in here and you can make it vent, not vent. You can pick the percentage that it's gonna purge. I'll have to do a video on evap systems for you guys. They're not real complicated.
You have to think of the evap system as a circle where the engine pulls a vacuum with the purge valve on the emission system, which is a fuel vapor system. And the vent is only used to control the tests. So they close the vent when you're testing the system for leaks and integrity, and they open the vent most of the time so it can pull the vapors out of the canister and the engine can consume them. It has to pull fresh air through the canister with the fuel vapors. So the vent's just used for testing the system. When they stick, you can't put gas in the car, things like that. But anyway, I'll make a separate video about that. Maybe I'll get out a whiteboard or something and do a evap system, basic evap system class or something like that.
On to the next car.
2016 Ford Expedition, 68,000 miles. Gave me a ticket to check AC. No explanation why, what happens. It seems to be blowing pretty cold.
Down in the 40s here in a second. There it is. Blowing in the 40s and dropping.
So, I have to go back up front and find out why they wanted the AC checked. Maybe they think they need to do a fall checkup. I love when they sell that kind of stuff. Not here, but anywhere. For home AC, car ACs. Oh, a spring checkup, fall checkup. It's working good. Leave it alone. Change the filter. 2015 Dodge Ram. 165,000 miles. Check engine light on. They called it an MIL light, but that's a maintenance indicator light. So it's not that. It's a check engine light, or SES. Service engine soon. See what kind of codes we got. Diesel drivability. Runs good. I already drove it. So I guess just a light. So it's probably a particulate filter warning or something along those lines. EGR code, pretty common on these things. They get carboned up and stuff. P1C54 SCR NOx catalyst missing.
Uh-oh.
That sounds expensive. We're going to have to jump on Identifix and see what's going on with that.
Man, that's a nasty code in that Dodge Ram. Reading the troubleshooter, it says diesel particulate filter DPF fluid for contamination. There's a refractometer and some test strips you got to use for two different kinds of contamination. You got to take a physical sample, do a visual inspection for contaminants. And then you got to test the pump for flow between 85 and 115 milliliters. And if it fails that, then it's something in the injector system. And if it's not that, it's the SCR or catalyst, which are pretty expensive on that thing. It also says if you keep driving it, you'll get a second warning telling you that it's going to take away your ability to drive over 5 miles an hour. And if you keep driving, it gives you a third warning. It says the next time you turn the key off, you'll lose your ability to go over 5 miles an hour. And if you keep driving it or let it in the idle, you let it idle for more than 1 hour, then it limits it to 5 miles per hour and tells you on the dash 5 miles an hour, or tells you on the dash 5 miles per hour maximum. See your dealer. They're pretty serious about the DPF system, apparently.
LaCrosse. I think it's like an 02 or 04. Let me see, I'll show here in a second. I'm putting a scanner on real quick because they handed me the parts. They're up there on the shelf, right up there. They handed me the parts and they said, here's a hub bearing and ABS sensor. Customers authorized it. So then I pulled it in, carried the parts out here, and they came out and said, hey, throw your scanner on real quick and make sure that's what it needs. Because the boss road tested the vehicle and saw that it needed, it had a code for an ABS sensor. So he sold everything and ordered the parts before looking at it or diagnosing it. That's undercover speak for you're not going to get paid for a diab, but go ahead and do one real quick when they say, throw your scanner on real quick and make sure that's what it needs. Man, I hate that. I'm going to get paid for it though, one way or another. Do 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 do. Throw your scanner on it real quick. Because the boss already sold it and ordered the parts. How would they unsell it? If the boss sold it and ordered the parts, this is what I wonder.
Turn you guys around.
If they ordered the parts and they already sold it and talked to the customer, what happens if I checked it and it has a bad ABS module? How do you unsell it? Luckily, they only do it a few times a week. So it's not like every day. It's like every other day. So. EBCM. It said ABS. Read fault code. DTC display. Uh-oh. Wheel speed sensor frequency error. Left front wheel speed sensor circuit range performance. That probably is an ABS hub.
So what I'll do now is I'll take it for a drive and we'll see what it does.
See what this, see what we're doing here. See if the left front drops out. The left front is the blue. I'm only on the back roads while I'm filming, driving and looking at the scanner. I'm not going on the main roads. So some people might be worried about my safety.
It's gonna be hard to diagnose if it doesn't do it very often.
They also got a harness, which is real common on these cars. Those harnesses go bad pretty regular. Just driving down these back roads, it's not really a, there's no traffic except for the people that have to work back here. But throw your scanner on it real quick, see if it's got a ABS hub bearing problem. So what happens when you in a shop where you work on a vehicle and they give you the parts and pre-sell it, you just throw them in and it was wrong, then it's their fault. So then real casually they go, throw your scanner on it, make sure first. That means I'm gonna make it your fault if that's not what it needed after we already sold it though. So in the parking lot, I'm just in this little back parking lot here. It's not doing anything. I'm gonna tell them it's, I don't see any problem with it right now. See what they wanna do. I'm not gonna drag that out any longer. I've been driving it for a little while now and it's not doing anything. So stopping and swerving the car left and right, trying to get it to show its ass. It's not happening. One more drive down this parking lot back to the shop. Then I hand the ball back to them in their court. And they can either pass or shoot. Alright. I'm gonna end this video there and we're gonna go on to the next car and see what
you guys have seen these yet. The cable repair ends, instead of changing the whole cable, you put these ends on. The ones that aren't white, anywhere there's a black end.
Put the light on.
Anyway, there's a black end, like down inside the door here. This one's black, and the other one's black. The other end's black, so the black ones crumble, and you have to replace them. Otherwise your door handle won't work because it lets the cable slide around. So that's what we're doing on this 2010 Ranger. Both rear doors, instead of replacing, because they want you to buy all the latches and everything. So someone creative made these aluminum ends. They look like before you put them on the cable. Pretty cool. It's a part number for them if anyone needs them.
They work. Monte Carlo carburetor's on there, running good.
It came in for a leaking carburetor, but I put a new carburetor on. It was leaking a couple spots. Weird thing is the choke wasn't wired right. It was wired to the field wire on the alternator rather than the ignition feed on the alternator. So the choke didn't work. We never mentioned any of that. So got all that working, runs like a charm now.
Chevy Cruze, 74,000 miles. About the life expectancy for these things. They had the check engine light diag while they did an oil change on it, apparently a month ago. And they cleaned the mass airflow sensor and check engine light came back on.
It's a 2016. So now I'm gonna do a diag on it. But this time we're gonna charge them for it. Cleaning a mass airflow sensor is good to test it. But once they've been contaminated, it's a better idea to replace them.
ETC display, intake air temp sensor 2, circuit low voltage. Intake air humidity sensor, circuit low voltage. P0097, P0054. Intake air temperature high voltage, P0113. Intake airflow system performance, P1101. Barrow sensor performance, 2227. Barrow sensor circuit high voltage, P2229. We're gonna dig into this thing, check for power and ground at the mass airflow, and run through the flow chart real quick, see where we go.
Put it in graphing mode with all my vital sensors that are setting codes, and everything looks good. I'm not seeing any dropouts or glitches in the graphs. Of course, this is all processed data, but it's showing you what the computer thinks it sees. All right, let's go on to the flow charts and see what it says.
Things I like about the Identifix is that you can take your code, put your code in up top, and it'll run through what things to check, what to go through. It has the most common faults that cause that code, which doesn't mean you start replacing these things, but it narrows down where you need to look. So it'll save you a bunch of time just going through these first three to see if those might be the culprit, because most likely they will be. You still need a diag, but it shortens the process for you. It's a great source of information as long as you don't start chucking parts on because of the
the list of possible problems. Still got a diag, but like I said, saves quite a bit of time.
All right, we got this cruise all fixed up. The code P1101 was the only one that returned, and none of the other codes came back. Driving on a road test, it has a dirty air filter, which is restricted, and a dirty throttle body. One of the tests for that code is to look at the throttle angle, and it's supposed to be between 8 and 12%. Is that 19 or 20%? So it's opening the throttle more than it wants to, and it's not happy about it, so it sets that code. What they're doing, all these manufacturers doing the same thing. They're making it really difficult to modify your car. So that system is super sensitive to airflow. So if you put an aftermarket air filter in there, it'll set this code. But the throttle angles will be below 8 to 12%. Because it's trying to reduce the airflow, and it'll set the same code. If the airflow is low, then it sets the code because it's open the throttle more than 8 to 12%. So it gets real angry about that. So something to make a note of. Clean the throttle body. The air filter was original because it's kind of a bitch to change in this car. So I went ahead and changed that out. Road tested it again, no more codes. So we're gonna let the customer take it and go further if we have to. These are pretty bad for intake manifolds and stuff, but normally, the throttle angle will be reduced in the case of a bad intake manifold. It doesn't get increased. An increase in throttle angle, obviously, like I said, is a restriction. So, seems like it's all fixed. We're going to take it on one more road test after it cools down before we deliver it back to the customer.
Ooh. Same truck I did the door cables on had a broken tailgate handle. The plastic only lives so long. 2010, so 10 years, I guess, is about how long it lives. I just had to, I grabbed the broken side with pliers, put a pair of needle nose, and got the tailgate open so I can get to it.
Look at that thing.
It's like a brand new car, truck.
Front and rear brakes on the potato car.
I'm so giddy. I don't get a lot of brake jobs. It's a hang and bang, rotors, pads, front and rear. Friday's turning out to be all right. Hey Jimmy, you mind doing an oil change real quick while you're doing those brakes? Not for 0.05. Oh, we'll pay you 0.3.
Sold.
Not always put on a new gasket. Fast idle. Cold start after letting it sit a few hours. I like to do the preliminary adjustments and then let it sit a few hours and see how it's going to start for the customer. Tack doesn't work either. Volt gauge reads low, temperature gauge reads high, but the oil gauge works. Fuel gauge doesn't work. Clock doesn't work. Down the idle. Parking brake don't work.
Got a little bit of the rusty vinyl top scenario going on here, cracks and stuff, but really a pretty clean car.
Nice.
This one's done. Customer came in with this sweet Windstar Limited. Their AC blows nice and cold, but they wanted to get fresh Freon. They said they wanted to do evac and recharge, so they had fresh Freon. I guess the boss didn't want to talk him out of it. He probably talked him into it. Fresh Freon it is. It's out of my hands, guys. 2017 F-250. Finishing out the week strong. It's about 4:30 on Friday. Got a blower motor and connector melted together. It wasn't working until I tugged on the connector. Give that a little tug, and the blower started working. Feel that ice cold air coming out at you? Yeah, there was no air a second ago. They must have went to the GM supplier for blower motors and resistors. Look at them out there. Look at them. What a handsome son of a bitch. Bill's gonna be on vacation next week. It's gonna be rough. They'll try to get me to do oil change for 0.05 labor. But it's not going to happen. I'm just telling you right now. I appreciate you guys watching. I do too much of the pew-pew thing, huh?
force of habit. Maybe I'll start a separate channel for that. I appreciate you guys watching. I hope you got something out of this episode. I hope you got something out of this, what do you want to call this? Hope you got something out of this vlog. Appreciate you tuning in and making it work. Hope it was worth your time. Make sure you leave a comment below. Like and subscribe. I appreciate you guys watching. See you in the next video. Just kidding. I got 14 of these episodes. If you haven't seen the others, go ahead and check them out. I hope you like some of the clips and tips and tricks I got in this week's episode. And I'm going to have some shorter versions I'll pull out of here. I actually started doing the short videos the right way this week too. Finally figured that out. Thanks guys. Appreciate you watching. Making it work.